Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger. Today let's look at how we prove theorems in chromogeometry. Chromogeometry is bringing together three different geometries at the same time. And the proofs are undeniably algebraic in nature. Let me illustrate what I'm talking about by having a look at two interesting and important theorems. So the first theorem concerns a point A and a line L, and we're interested in explicit formulas for the three altitudes from the point A to the line L. So if the point A is given by X naught, Y naught, and if the line L is given by A to B to C, and I remind you that that means that the line L has equation AX plus BY plus C equals zero, then the three altitudes, the blue, red, and green altitudes from A to L are given by these three formulas. So the blue altitude is B to minus A to minus B X naught plus A Y naught. The red one, B to A to minus B X naught minus A Y naught. And the green one, A to minus B to minus A X naught plus B Y naught. All right, so it's relatively simple to see why this is true. Why is it? So we start with our line L here. First, we have to convince you that this line L is, say, blue perpendicular to this one. So how do we get perpendicularity from the equations of lines? What we have to do is compute this times this plus this times this. That's our notion of blue perpendicularity when that quantity is zero. So A times B plus B times minus A, well, that is indeed zero. So this line is perpendicular to this line in the blue sense, independent of what this quantity is. And this quantity is what it is simply to ensure that the point X naught, Y naught lies on the line. In other words, if we form B times X naught plus minus A times Y naught plus this quantity, we get zero. Similarly, with the red altitude, what we have to compute for perpendicularity is that A times B minus B times A is zero. And again, that's true automatically. And then this quantity here is just to guarantee that the point A lies on the line. And our green notion of perpendicularity involves taking these expressions and taking this times this plus this times that. So A times minus B plus B times A, and that is indeed zero, so those two lines are green perpendicular. Now these three altitudes have a especially pleasant relationship with each other, and you can see it over here in this example. So there's our line L, there's our point A, there's the blue altitude, there's the red altitude, and there's the green altitude. And so here we have a notion of red perpendicular there, blue perpendicularity there, green perpendicularity there. But something else is true, something in addition, given by this theorem, that the red and the green altitudes are blue perpendicular. And the blue and the green altitudes are red perpendicular, and the blue and the red altitudes are green perpendicular. So for example, the blue and the red altitudes, they are actually green perpendicular. Similarly for the other pairs of two altitudes. So this picture actually contains a number of what I call triply right triangles. Triangles which are mutually perpendicular to each other. So there's a red perpendicularity at one corner, a blue perpendicularity at another corner, and a green perpendicularity at another corner. That's also another one, and that's also another one. And if you move any of these three lines, then the blue, red, and the green altitudes form another triply right triangle. Okay, so how do we check this theorem? Again, we just look at the equations of the lines and we check perpendicularity. So let's say, let's check the green one. So let's check that the blue and the red altitudes are green perpendicular. So how do we check that? Well, we have to check that this times this plus this times this equals zero, and it's automatic because B times A plus minus A times B, that is indeed zero, so those are automatically green perpendicular. So let's suppose that we have three points a1, a2, a3 with arbitrary coordinates x1, y1, x2, y2, and x3, y3. What we'd like to do is we'd like to have formulas for the various quantities of interest. And then we can use those formulas to prove things. So here are the formulas for the orthocenters of the triangle formed by those three points. And there are three different orthocenters, I remind you, because the three altitudes of different colors meet at different points. There's a blue one, a red one, and a green one. And there's some new notation here that allows me to write these formulas relatively compactly. If I wrote them out as polynomials divided by polynomials, they would be much longer. So here's a kind of a new notation that's very convenient that allows us to describe polynomials that have a certain anti-symmetric property in a relatively short, concise way. So here's the example. Let's consider x1, y2. That's an expression. And I'm going to put brackets around it with a little minus sign here. This minus sign is going to indicate that we're talking about something that's anti-symmetric. And by definition, this expression means a certain polynomial created from this term by doing what? By replacing the indices 1 and 2 with all the other possible indices that you get by rotating around the numbers 1, 2, and 3. So we have six terms with all possible permutations of the indices 1, 2, and 3 together with what's called the sign of the permutation, which is either plus or minus 1. So you can do the same thing with any expression, even something like this. So you just take that thing and go through the six possible permutations with plus and minus 1s. All right, so there's the expressions for the orthocenter, the blue one, red one, and green one, in terms of a ratio of an anti-symmetric polynomial of this kind divided by this particular anti-symmetric polynomial, which is the same one that's given up here. So this one here has a very special role in the subject. In fact, it's just the signed area formed by the triangle A1, A2, A3. We'll talk a little bit more about this important expression later on. If it's going to be zero exactly when the three points are collinear. We're assuming it's a triangle, so the denominators here can never be zero. And you can stare at these. It's interesting formulas. There's some relation. These ones are pretty close. There's a pleasant combination. Now let's have a look at the corresponding formulas for the circumcenters of the same triangle. So here are the expressions for the three circumcenters of the general triangle. And these are obtained in the same way as the orthocenter formulas are, by taking our expressions for points, lines, we know altitudes, so we create altitudes or perpendicular bisectors, and then we use our formulas for the meets of lines to generate these points. And once we've got them on our computers, usually, because we're usually using a computer to help us with the calculations, then we can express the rational functions that occur in terms of this more compact anti-symmetric polynomial notation. And notice also that the green circumcenter has a formula which is decidedly simpler than the blue and the red ones. Somewhat interesting that that's quite a familiar phenomena in chromogeometry. The green geometry tends to be a little bit simpler to work with than the blue and the red. So these kinds of formulas are the things that you have to work with when you do proofs. And admittedly, it's very algebraic. Often a computer helps a lot. And that's just the way the subject is. There are many then interesting relations and identities that are really behind the various theorems that one can prove. We're going to see a lot more examples of chromogeometry in action, but in our next video we're going to go back to something much more basic. So we're going to return to some rational trigonometry in the plane, very practical applications. We're going to talk about acute and obtuse triangles and the triangle spread rules. So I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.